Hello friends, and welcome in today's session. Today we are going to learn about the different population interactions. In the last video we have seen the different interactions, but in that also predation also we have seen little bit. Once again see here in the predation, along with the predation whatever the other population interactions are there, that also all we will see today. So see here, predation. In the predation we know that predator and prey, two types of animals are there, and the importance of each of them is there in the community, right? So how the predator is able to keep the population under control, because of the predator biodiversity is maintained in the ecosystem, right? So this is given, examples are given here of the prickly pree, right? See here, it is given that in Australia there is a havoc caused because of spreading rapidly of millions of hectares of prickly pear cactus, right? It is widely spreading in the Australia, right? Now how to control this prickly pear cactus? So for that, for this cactus, predator has introduced there in that area, and because of this predator, this cactus remains under the control. See, cactus was brought under control only after cactus feeding predator, a moth. It is a moth, from its natural habitat was introduced in the country, and this is what it is called as a biological control. So this we have seen even here in the American Pacific Coast, starfish, pastor is there. Actually, it is a very important predator is there. But when in the experiment, when all the starfish were removed from a particular intercoastal area, then from that area, more than 10 species of invertebrates were extinct within 1 year, right? Now you will say that if the predator is removed, then why the other invertebrates, actually these are the prey, then why they have lost? Because as the predator is not there, they have grown enormously, and due to their enormous growth, there is a interspecific competition, and in the competition they get extinct within 1 year. Near about 10 species of invertebrate get extincted in 1 year. Just we have removed their predator. So this is what the importance of the predator means. They maintain the population of their prey in the ecosystem. Whenever predator is too efficient and over exploit its prey, then also predator will also get extinct, because prey is its food, right? So if the prey is over exploited, then might be the prey will get extinct, and if the prey will not there, then predator will also be extinct after some time. The reason is that the lack of food, they will not get food, so they will get extinct, die and get extinct, right? So in this way, predator is important for the biodiversity, to maintain the population of the prey under control, as well as prey also has to be maintained their number, right? Now for this, to maintain the number of prey species in the ecosystem, they have also developed some of the defensive mechanisms, right? That is nothing but example is given, there are some of the species of insect and frog, right? They are having a cryptically colored, means camouflage is there, so they will get easily hide into the background, and they will get saved themselves from the predator. Some of the plants are there, they becomes poisonous, and because of that they will not get eaten up by the animals. Here one more example is given of the monarch butterfly. This is become highly distasteful for its predator, and this is specially developed due to secreting a chemical during its caterpillar stage. and this is done by feeding on a one of the poisonous weed. So because of this distasteful taste of the monarch butterfly, they get saved from their predators. Another is that herbivores are the predators of the plants, right? So plants cannot move from their place, so they will also develop the some of the mechanism in their body. So because of that, they will get protected from their predators, right? Means herbivores. So example is given, morphological defense as well as chemical defense. In the morphological defense, thorns are developed in acacia and cactus, right? And in chemical defense, the calotropis is there. They have developed a poisonous cardiac glycoside which will cause a cardiac arrest to the animals, those who will graze on it, right? So in this way they get protected. This is how predation point is given. Along with this calotropis, nicotine, caffeine, quinine, starchin, opium is there. They are producing the defensive chemical and protect themselves against the grazers or the browsers. Now the second type of interaction is a competition. Now you must have heard about the competition in Darwin's theory of evolution, that whenever the species number will be high, then they will compete with each other for their common resources, right? So we will see how the competition is there. In population interaction, we have also seen that whenever there is a competition type of interaction is there between the two species, then both will be there in a loss, right? So see about the competition. Competition is an interaction among the individuals of same species, that is intraspecific, or between the individuals of a different species. Two different species will be there, then that is the interspecific competition, right? So the competition may be intraspecific or a interspecific. So whenever the competition is takes place, this competition is takes place between the individuals of the same species for same resources. As the same species is there, their needs will also be the same. So they will compete with each other for the same resource. And as this resource is limited, there will be competition to get that resource to them maximally, right? In some cases, if resources need not to be limiting for the competition to occur, the feeding efficiency of one species might be reduced due to the interfering of the other species. Yes, this can be also one more reason for the competition, that suppose the resources are not limiting, means there are abundant resources are there, huge amount of resources are there, then also there is a competition between the two species. Now this competition is because of feeding efficiency. One species will feed how much fast and another species will eat how much fast. Now see, if one of the species efficiency, feeding efficiency is high and second species feeding efficiency is very slow, then definitely the first species will feed fast and over the food. Second species will not get any food and may get die or extinct. So this is why one more reason for the competition, that is the feeding efficiency. Example is given, abandoned tortoise is there in Galapagos Island, become extinct. This species of tortoise get extinct on Galapagos Island because within a decade, this is extinct get within a decade because whenever the goats are introduced on that island, after introduction of the goats, these tortoise get extinct. So reason here is the goat. Now why this tortoise get extinct? Just because of the goat. Goats are not eating the tortoise, but the food, tortoise as well as goat, both are eating the plants, right? Both are herbivores. And grazing capacity is there, that is more of the goat than the tortoise. So as the goats were introduced, they go on grazing at their highest level and very 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 fast, and because of that in short period of time the plants get over in that area, and just lack of food these tortoises get extinct. So in this way grazing feeding efficiency is there, that may lead for the competition. Then the same it is given, the goats had higher browsing efficiency than the tortoise. Next, see, unrelated species also compete for the same resources, right? Now possibility is that the two species which are two species are there, their resources may be the same, right? And if the same resource is there, then possibility is that two different species will compete for that common resource. Example is given, flamingo and fish. Now here flamingo is one different species and fish is another species, right? So both are having a competition among themselves for zooplanktons, right? So here common resource is the zooplankton, and these two different species compete with each other. So here we can see the different species or the same species compete with each other for different purpose. See, the competitive release means what? In competitive release, suppose a species A is there, in that distribution of the species A is restricted to a very small geographical area. Means that species A is just growing in a small area only. Now why this species is growing in a small area? Because there is another species in that area, one more species is growing, and because of the presence of that species which is competitively superior species for A, right? As compared to A, this second species is there, this is the superior, right? According to the competition, this species is superior for species A, and that species is called as a competitive release. And whenever we will remove this competitive release species, means second species which is a superior species, if we will remove the from that area, then we can found that the species A is there, it will be expand its distributional range dramatically, means it will grow in a vast area, large area, right? And when this will happen, when we remove this competing species completely, right? So this is what a competitive release. Next point is Gauss competitive exclusion principle, right? Now in this Gauss principle, he said that two closely related species are there, they are competing for the same resources, cannot exist together. Two species who are competing with each other for the same resource will not be exist together, right? And competitively inferior species is there, means weak species is there, that will get be eliminated by the superior one. So out of these two, any one will survive over there whenever the two species are competing for the same resource. This is what said by the Gauss, right? Gauss principle. Now one more point is there, resource partitioning. Resource partitioning, partition is done for the resource. One major resource is for the organism is nothing but a food, right? Suppose 2-3 species are there, those who are living together and they have the same resource for the food, then what they do? Are they killing to each other and only one is surviving according to the Gauss? No. These all species will get survive, just they are partitioning their resources. Now how they are partitioning? See here, it is the mechanism meant for coexistence, means all the species will be remain survive to face competition, right? Competition is there and that competition will be reduced and all the species will be remain alike. Now how is this possible? According to this partitioning, resource partitioning, if two species compete for the same resource, they could avoid competition by choosing different time for feeding or different foraging pattern. Either they will change the time for feeding, means suppose one species is feeding on the upper surface, then another species may feed on the lower surface. Take an example, suppose one pond is there, right? So in that three different species of fish are surviving, then they will just make a partition in the pond that some of the species of the fish they will feed in the superficial layer of the pond, some will be the middle area they will feed, and some species of fish will feed at the bottom area. So as these areas are divided, there will be no any competition for the food in that same pond. So in one pond, three different types of species can survive very easily, that is also without competition. This is what it is called as a coexistence, right? There is a no competition, they will survive together, right? Or timing will also be changed, means change the time. One of the species will feed in the during the daytime, another species will feed during the night time. So in this way, change in time or maybe feeding pattern will be changed, right? So in this way, competition will be avoided. Here example is given. MacArthur showed that five closely related species of warblers living on the same tree were able to coexist together and avoid competition by having behavioral differences in their foraging, that is hunting activities. Means they have chosen different types of food. Some may eat seeds, some may eat fruit, some may eat worms, right, or insects, and some may eat the leaves of the plant. So in this way they have changed their hunting patterns, right, eating pattern, and in this way five different species of birds can survive on one tree, single tree, in a common habitat without competition. Different species can be survived. This is what it is said in coexistence, right? Now see in your textbook, according to the Darwin, there is a struggle for existence and the fittest is there, strongest is there, that will get survive, right? So competition always occur in close related species for the same resource which are limiting. But this is not always true, because we have seen that unrelated species also may compete for the same resource, right? Here example is given. Some shallow South American lakes, visiting flamingos and resident fishes compete for their common food, that is nothing but the zooplankton in a lake. Secondly, resource need not to be limiting for the competition. This is not always compulsory that resources are limiting, right? If the resources are unlimited, then also competition may occur, right? So this is just because of feeding efficiency of the species. Here we have seen already the example of goat and tortoise, right? Then Gauss experimental statement is there. What he said, when the resources are limited, competitively superior species will eventually eliminate the other species, and in this way weaker win will be Gauss. But evidences for such competitive exclusion occurring in the nature is not always conclusive, right? Here it is given about the competitive release, that one species having very restricted geographical area, whenever another species is there, due to presence of the another species, this species is not growing. but when we remove this dominant species from that area, automatically this species will grow exponentially, right? Conness elegant field experiment. It shows that the rocky sea coast of Scotland, the larger and competitively superior barnacles, that is Balanus, dominates the intertidal area and excludes the smaller barnacles, that is Cathamalus, from that zone. So this is what it is given by the Cornell. Then Gauss competitive exclusion principle is given here, that two closely related species competing for the same resource cannot coexist indefinitely here. But here again we have seen that this competition can be avoided by coexistence, right? So here it is given the resource partitioning. They will, species will not compete for each other, but they will change their foraging pattern or feeding time, right? And they will be exist with each other. There will be no competition. They will avoid competition and coexist with each other due to behavioral difference in their foraging activities. Now the third is the parasitism, right? Now in the parasitism, we know that one species will be a parasite and second species will be a host. Now in the parasitism, the interspecific interaction where one of the species that will be a parasite depends on the another species, which will be called as a host, for food and shelter, right? So who is depend on other, that is a parasite, and on whom the parasite is depend is a host, right? Here the parasite get benefited, so it is shown in the plus, while host get harmed because of the parasite, so host is shown in minus. So in this type of interaction, one species is benefited and other species is get harmed, right? So in this case, parasite and host specific interaction is there, and their evolution is also co-evolution. Now co-evolution means what? If there is any change in the host, right? As the host evolves, then this parasite which is depend on that host will also evolve along with the host, according to the host. For example, see the mechanism to reject or resist the parasite if it is developed by the host. Then parasite will also evolve the mechanism to neutralize this rejections or the resistance. And in this way, both will evolve at the same time. Due to evolution of the host, evolution in parasite is occur. Parasite also shows some of the adaptations. Because of that, the parasite is able to survive on the host. First adaptation is parasite tends to co-evolve. Means how the host will evolve, according to that, parasite will also immediately evolve itself. Second, loss of sense organs are there. No need of any kind of sense organs, right? Because it don't have to run away from the predators or anything. It has just be there on the host body and take the direct nutrition. So there is no need of sense organs. So the sense organs are lost in the parasite. Then to absorb the food from the host, suckers or hooks are developed. So they are very nicely developed in case of parasite. Loss of digestive system. As the parasite is taking ready-made digested food from the host body, the parasite no need to digest it once again, right? So that's why no need of a digestive system in the parasite's body. So the parasite will lose the digestive system. Then it has to reproduce in a highest level. So high reproductive capacity is also developed. So these are some of the adaptations which we see in the parasite. Some of the parasites have a complex life cycle and generally have one or two intermediate hosts. They are not depend on only one host, right? Means in between the first host, they may have two more hosts. Take an example, If we see the malarial parasite, then malarial parasite has a two host. One is a human being and another one is a mosquito. So they have completed their life cycle with these two host only. Out of these two host, if any one is absent, then also these malaria parasite is not able to complete their life cycle, right? Another example is also given here, human liver fluke. It has a two intermediate host, that is snail and a fish. So human liver, in human's liver, this liver fluke is found. This is what the picture of the liver fluke. It can get transmitted into the snail's body, and from the snail it can transfer to the fish body and once again into the human body. So here for this parasite there are two intermediate hosts, and in case of malarial protozoa, malarial parasite, it has a two host. One is the human and second one is the mosquito, right? So they have the intermediate host, two or more. Another, see, there are some of the parasites who live on the body of the organism, right? Means externally they live on the body. So if the parasite is living on the surface of the host body, then it is from the outer side, right, of the body. So it is called as ectoparasite. And if the parasite is living inside the body internally, right, then it is called as the endoparasite. Example is given here, human lice. You know that the lice will be there in the hairs. If you we will not wash our hairs properly, if we will not take care of the hairs regularly, then possibility is that lice will grow in the hair. So as they are living externally of our body, they will be come in the category of ectoparasite. Even the ticks are there, they are also ectoparasite. Then copepods are the ectoparasites on the marine fish. Cuscuta, one more parasite is there. This is the parasite on the plant, right? Means the all green plants are there, majority in the trees or shrubs are there. On this cuscuta is growing and it is a parasitic. Here is, it is a image given. Here you can see a wire like structure is there. It is yellow in color and the name of this is known as a cuscuta. It generally grows on a trees or a shrub. This structure, which is just penetrated into the stem of the plant, is called as a haustoria, and because of this haustoria they are just sucking the ready made food from this host plant, right? They don't have leaves, they don't have chlorophyll, they do not prepare their own food. So this is a parasite in case of a plant. So cuscuta is a parasite on a plant. It has lost chlorophyll as well as leaves during the evolution, right? Because it get direct nutrition from the host plant by the haustoria. Now we will see the points from the textbook of the same parasitism type of interaction. See in your textbook, in the parasitism, it will ensure free loading and meals for the parasite from the host, right? So it is a, many parasites have evolved to be a host specific, and co-evolution is seen in them. As the host evolved, parasite will also evolve. This we have seen, right? Then how the host is able to reject them, resist them, all this will be get neutralized by the parasite, right? Some of the parasite has evolved some of the adaptations. This we have discussed already, right? Then intermediate host, one or two intermediate hosts are there, right? This also we have seen. Ectoparasite, those who are feeding external surface of the host organism. Example, lice on human, ticks on dogs, right? Marine fish are infested with the ectoparasite, that is copepods. Cuscuta is there for the plants, right? So these are some of the ectoparasites. There are also endoparasite. We have seen a liver fluke example, which is found inside the human body in a liver. So that will come in a endoparasite, right? Then here some of the adaptations of the Cuscuta's are given. Endoparasite lives inside the host of the body at a different size, maybe in liver, kidney, lungs, red blood cells, etc. Right? Life cycle of the endoparasites are more complex as compared to the ectoparasite. Morphological and anatomical features are there. They are greatly simplified while emphasizing their reproductive potential. They are reproductively potential, means can reproduce on a highest rate, right? But whatever other structures are there, they are just very simply developed, right? Next point is brood parasitism. Now brood parasitism, it will be asked for 2 marks in the exam, right? In this, what happened? Brood parasitism means brood. This is a kind of a nest in case of birds. So in for the nest also there is a parasitism. For that example is given, that is the parasitic bird lays its egg in the nest of its host, right? So this parasitic bird use host's nest for laying the eggs. And maybe all of you know the example that quail, right? Cuckoo and the crow, right? As you know, crow build its own house, right? And quail never build its own house, right? Nest is not formed. Whenever the cuckoo has to lay her eggs, then she will lay her eggs in crow's nest, right? So along with the crow's nest, these cuckoo's eggs will also be grown. Now who is growing and taking care of these eggs? This is all done by the crow, right? Why? Because crow is thinking that these eggs are his own, right? Not of cuckoo's. Now how is it possible? Because cuckoo has evolved the mechanism that the eggs of cuckoos will be looking similar morphologically, right? Color, structure, spots, size, it is similar as like the host eggs. So automatically the host bird cannot differentiate their eggs and the parasite eggs. So automatically the host bird will grow both the types of egg. This is what it is called as a brood parasitism. The eggs of the parasite bird have evolved to resemble the host egg in the size and color. So this will be done to reduce the chances of host bird detecting the foreign eggs and ejecting them out from the nest. Example is given cuckoo, quail and the crow, right? So prepare this. So today we have seen about some of the population interactions. In that a little bit about the parasitism also I have shown you, right? Then before that we have seen about the competition, and before that predation, right? So these all population interactions are very important. In this you have to remember most of all examples. Most of the time question will be asked on the examples only. So whatever and various types of examples you are getting, for this all you have to collect for every type of interaction. Up to this, prepare your notes, complete it, and prepare well. All the best.